tonight, at least 9 people are killed as severe tropical storm Maring batters the northern Philippines.
The Philippines Anti-Graft Court dismisses a multi-million peso graft complaint against former tourism chief Juan Dateo.
Russia brands Kremlin critic Alexei Navalny as a terrorist.
And the governor of Texas defies the vaccine mandate of U.S. President Biden.
Good evening. I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, a severe tropical storm batters parts of the largest Philippine island. A look at the devastation left by Maring in tonight's top story.
Severe tropical storm Maring brought heavy rains in the northern part of the Philippines. It triggered several landslides in Baguio City. One home was buried, killing a grandfather and his 2 grandchildren. Another landslide in La Trinidad in Benguet killed 3 siblings.
8 o'clock, kumakain sila. Natabunan po, nag-slide po yung lupa, kaya natabunan yung bahay.
Floodwaters also submerged a strawberry farm, also in La Trinidad. The lake in Burnham Park in Baguio overflowed. Maring also triggered floods in Saud Village in Pagudpud, Ilocos Norte. Several villages in Ilocos Sur were also flooded. At least 2 bridges were damaged due to the strong river current. The Quirino Stadium in Bantay Municipality was also damaged. Heavy rains also caused flooding in parts of La Union. One evacuation center was not spared from the floods. Evacuees were transferred to different schools. In Caba Municipality, 2 barges ran aground due to strong waves.
Select Philippine hospitals are gearing up for the pilot rollout of COVID jabs for minors with comorbidities. Vivian Gulia reports.
The Philippine Children's Medical Center is making a master list of patients who are qualified and willing to be jabbed. They need to be 12 to 17 years old and have a medical certificate for a comorbidity that falls within the 11 illnesses listed by the Department of Health. The patient and parent or guardian must also consent to the vaccination.
We've got around 22, but that number is expected to balloon, okay, because now the people here, they are trying their best to be able to explain the benefits of giving the vaccine, okay, to the patients. And mukha namang maganda ang reception.
In Fedelmundo Medical Center, around 250 patients have so far registered for vaccination. It targets to vaccinate an initial 60 children on Friday.
Nag-create muna kami ng Google link, no, para ma-identify namin yung mga possible na vaccine recipients. Ang priority talaga would be yung patients namin dito and yung mga dependents din na may comorbidity.
The National Children's Hospital is scheduled to hold a simulation for the COVID vaccination of minors on Wednesday. These hospitals assure patients and parents they are ready to respond should vaccine recipients report side effects.
Yung difficulty of breathing, no, and then yung anaphylaxis din. That's why may naka-ready naman kami dong emergency cart, no, tapos may stretcher din, tapos may mga gamot din kami for the mga yung allergies kung mahirapang huminga. And then kung halimbawa kinakailangan talaga silang dalhin kaagad sa ER, madadala naman namin sila sa ER.
Apart from PCMC, Fedelmundo, and National Children's Hospital, 5 other hospitals in Metro Manila were designated as pilot jabbing sites for minors. The National Vaccination Operations Center says each hospital will receive an initial 1,170 COVID vaccine doses. but supply will be augmented as needed. So far, only Pfizer and Moderna's COVID jabs have emergency use authorization for children 12 to 17 years old in the Philippines. Of the over 87.6 million COVID vaccine doses that arrived in the country, around 21 million are manufactured by Pfizer, while 9.9 million are Moderna. The private sector, which procured Moderna doses, is also eyeing to vaccinate their employees' children. President Duterte, meanwhile, hopes major cities in the country would be able to vaccinate half of their target population this year. The country has fully vaccinated 30% of its target 77 million Filipinos, which is 70% of the total Philippine population.
We are confident that most, if not all, major cities in the country will be hit and even surpass this target before Christmas. Sana.
Meantime, an advisory group to the World Health Organization recommends an additional COVID shot for immunocompromised individuals. The Strategic Advisory Group of Experts on Immunization adds a third dose should be offered to senior citizens vaccinated with Sinovac and Sinopharm's COVID jabs. NVOC Chair and Health Undersecretary Mirna Cabotaje says this will be raised to the country's all-experts group, who are scheduled to meet this week for their recommendation. But for the Philippine Food and Drug Administration, it sees no need for COVID-19 booster shots for now. FDA Director General Eric Domingo says his agency has found no waning effects in the shots administered in the country. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
A shorter curfew in the Philippine capital region will take effect Wednesday. It will begin at 12 midnight and will be enforced until 4 a.m. The easing of the curfew hours comes ahead of a possible downgrading of Metro Manila's COVID alert from the current level 4. Authorities are considering a lower alert level as COVID cases appear to be declining in the region. The Philippines on Tuesday logged 8,615 new COVID infections. Three laboratories were unable to submit data. 236 more deaths and 25,000 new recoveries were also recorded.
The Philippine Senate President sees a need to amend the country's election code. Claims by several politicians that a controversial rule on candidate substitution is being abused. Sherry-Ann Torres reports.
The filing of the certificates of candidacy has come and gone, but speculations persist. New presidential and vice presidential bets will emerge on or before the substitution deadline on November 15. The last-minute filing of some bets, including relatively unknown personalities, only spur further suspicion. Last Friday, Senator Ronald Bato de la Rosa filed his COC for president under the PDP Laban Cusi wing. De La Rosa also said he is willing to withdraw from the race anytime should Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte finally decides to join the presidential derby. A certain Ana Capela Velasco of Lakas CMD also filed her COC for president last October 8. Minutes later, her party mate Lyle Fernando Uy filed his COC for vice president. Monday evening, Lakas Secretary General Prospero Pichai told ABS-CBNNews.com Velasco and Uy are considered as placeholders and they can still be replaced. While waiting for either Mayor Duterte or former Senator Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. to join them.
Parang placeholders po yung dalawa na yan, sir.
But on ANC Head Start Tuesday morning, Pichai claimed that there was no such plan on the part of Lakas.
And there was no question, are they placeholders? Because
no, there was no record, question about placeholders.
Yes, yes.
In the first place, I do not even understand the word placeholders until you mentioned it today.
This comes even as Marcos has announced his presidential bid under Partido Federal na Pilipinas, where he sits as party chairman. As for the younger Duterte, she has repeatedly said she will not run for president. Both parties are taking this tactic, even if the Davao City Mayor has filed her COC to seek re-election for a third and final term. Senator Aquilino Coco Pimentel III of the PDP Laban Pacquiao Wing says some groups today are using the substitution option as a political strategy. But the senator points out this extension is now being abused and a fake candidate should be considered as a nuisance candidate. The camp of Senator Manny Pacquiao, who is also a presidential bet, maintains there is no need for all the drama.
Sana pag meron pong talagang tao na gusto mamuno sa bansa, na gusto maging presidente ng Pilipinas, dapat siya ay handa. Dapat doon pa lang sa period of filing, mag-file na po sila. Tigilan na po natin itong drama na may mga substitution pa tayo.
Section 69 of the Omnibus Election Code states, the Commission on Elections can disqualify a candidate who will mock or disrepute the election process or will cause confusion among voters. Aspirants who will be found to have no bona fide intention to run for office can also be disqualified. In the law, a candidate who dies, gets disqualified, or withdraws from the race can be replaced by a party mate. Senate President Vicente Soto III, the vice presidential running mate of Senator Panfilo Lacson, sees the need to amend the Omnibus Election Code. The Isko Moreno Doc Willie-Ong ticket also deplores this strategy, calling it a mockery of the people's sovereign right to choose their leaders wisely and properly. The team's campaign manager Lito Banayo says voters should reject politicians who are subverting the election process. The PDP Laban Cusi wing is unfazed, arguing it is allowed in the rules.
Kung ibig sa makiri, kung mali yan, eh sabi po natin sa COMELEC, huwag na kayong maglagay ng ganyan ng period. Isang period na lang, pagtapos ng October 8, wala na. But if it's within the rules, within the resolution of the COMELEC, it stands fair play also.
Sharian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Former Philippine Tourism Secretary Juan Dateo is cleared in a graft complaint that stemmed from an advertising deal between her former agency and the state-run PTV4 network. Ombudsman Samuel Martires junked the complaint due to lack of probable cause. The Commission on Audit in 2018 flagged the tourism department's move to place 66 million pesos in TV advertisements on a PTV4 show featuring Teo's brothers Ben and Erwin Tulfo. But Teo denied any conflict of interest, claiming that she did not earn a single centavo from the contract.
Three soldiers are convicted for the 1986 killing of Philippine labor leader Rolando Olalla and union worker Leonor Alayay. An anti-polo court sentenced Fernando Casanova, Dennis Habatan, and Desiderio Perez to serve up to 40 years in prison. The three were all members of the Reform the Armed Forces movement. Olalla's son, Rolando Rigo, is a private prosecutor in the case. He says the fight for justice is not yet over as nine other suspects remain at large. The president of the National Union of People's Lawyers, Edre Olalla, welcomed the court's decision with both relief and frustration. Edre is the second cousin of the slain labor leader who was abducted with Alayay in Pasig City. They were believed to be tortured and later gunned down.
Other parts of the Philippines are also reeling from the effects of severe tropical storm Maring. As this report tells us, the storm has left at least 9 people dead.
Police in Cagayan rescued residents trapped in their homes by rising floodwaters. 35 families in 4 villages were safely evacuated. In Santa Teresita, the Philippine Coast Guard helped evacuate nearly a dozen families from rising floodwaters. Local disaster officials say 80 villages in 19 towns were inundated. Nearly 3,000 families are affected.
Ang una pong ginawa namin, no, sa pagpaplano namin, isang paghihiwalay po ng ating COVID cases dun po sa evacuation centers po natin.
Floods also submerged schools. Classrooms in Sipatoyo Elementary School were left with thick mud when the flood subsided. In the municipality of Rizal, a portion of the road in Gagabutan West was destroyed. Crop damage is estimated to be worth more than 14 million pesos. Floods also hit Brooks Point Municipality in Palawan. Members of the Philippine Coast Guard and rescue teams helped affected residents evacuate. In Davao Oriental, one ship ran aground due to strong waves. More than a dozen homes were also destroyed. Strong waves caused a barge to tilt on its side, this time in Batangas Province. More than 2 dozen people on board were rescued. According to the disaster agency, as of Tuesday, there have been 9 fatalities, 11 reported missing, and more than 400 families affected by Maring.
Coming up, North Korean leader Kim Jong-un tries to justify his country's weapons development.
And Texas Governor Greg Abbott bans all COVID-19 vaccine mandates in the state. The World Tonight returns after the break. Back on The World Tonight, North Korean leader Kim Jong-un says his country's military buildup is their defense against what he calls the hostile policies of South Korea and the United States. This report.
Standing beside North Korea's largest missiles, leader Kim Jong-un defended his country's weapons development on Monday. State media carried comments from Kim saying it was necessary to increase the North's military for self-defense in the face of hostile policies from the US and South Korea. Kim made the comments in his speech at the Defense Development Exhibition on Monday, according to a report by state news agency KCNA. Photos in the ruling party newspaper showed Kim standing next to the country's largest intercontinental ballistic missiles that have been unveiled but not yet test-fired. A spokesperson for South Korea's defense ministry said they were monitoring the situation closely. South Korea recently test-fired its first submarine-launched ballistic missile and has bought American-made F-35 stealth fighters. North Korea has pushed ahead with its missile program, and analysts say it has begun a major expansion of its main nuclear reactor for fuel for nuclear weapons. The US has said it is willing to hold diplomatic talks at any time with Pyongyang.
Russian dissident Alexei Navalny says his country's prison service has designated him as a terrorist. Navalny says a prison committee voted unanimously to change his status. He made light of the announcement and welcomed how he's no longer considered a flight risk. The staunch critic of Russian President Vladimir Putin has been behind bars for nearly 9 months on an embezzlement charge. Navalny is also accused of setting up an extremist group. This could get him 10 more years in prison if convicted.
British lawmakers published a report highlighting lapses in the UK's COVID-19 response. And Thailand reopens its doors to fully vaccinated travelers. More global COVID-19 updates in this report.
The delay of the British government's decision to impose lockdowns led to a worse COVID-19 outbreak in the UK than in other countries. That's according to a report by the British Parliament's Health and Science Committees. Lawmakers also slammed the government's test and trace program, as well as errors that led to COVID-19 outbreaks among the elderly and the vulnerable. But the report also highlighted successes, such as the government's vaccination rollout. All types of COVID-19 vaccine mandates in the U.S. state of Texas are now banned, including those by private companies. U.S. President Joe Biden has ordered large U.S. companies to require their employees to get vaccinated against COVID-19. But Republican Texas Governor Greg Abbott accuses Biden of federal overreach. Thailand to welcome fully inoculated visitors from at least 10 nations by November. These nations, which are considered low risk, include the United Kingdom, China, Germany, and the U.S. Thai Prime Minister Prayut Chan-o-cha says this is to boost the country's pandemic-ravaged tourism sector. Thailand lost about $50 billion in tourism revenue in 2020 due to the pandemic.
Police in the U.S. state of Ohio in hot water after they allegedly manhandled a paraplegic African-American. The details in this report.
A black paraplegic man in Ohio has accused the Dayton Police Department of racial profiling and brutality after body cam footage released last week showed officers dragging him out of his car on suspicion of a drugs crime.
So you can cooperate and get out of the car, I'll drag you out of the car. You see your two options here?
39-year-old Clifford Owensby filed a complaint with the NAACP over the weekend, accusing officers of total humiliation, telling reporters, quote, "They dragged me like a dog, like trash." Dayton police said officers had been observing a suspected drug house, stopping Owensby after seeing him depart from the house in his car. Body cam video shows Owensby handing over his identification, which police said revealed he had been convicted of illegally possessing drugs and guns. The officer then orders him out of the car so it can be checked by a drug-sniffing police dog. Owensby demands to speak with police supervisors before the argument escalates. He threatens a lawsuit if police lay hands on him before calling someone to the scene to record what's happening. One officer pulls Owensby out by his hair as he screams for help, before pinning him down to the street, handcuffing him, and dragging him away. Police say a bag containing over $22,000 in cash, which a sniffer dog identified as having been near illegal drugs, was later found in the car. Owensby told reporters the money was savings, that no drugs or weapons were found in his vehicle, and that he was not charged with any drug-related crime. Local media said he was charged with resisting arrest.
We explained it to you several times.
The PSE index pulls back from Monday's rally and tracks other downbeat Asian markets. Michelle Ong reports.
Most Asian markets under pressure on Tuesday as the global energy crunch stoked inflation worries. Philippine shares also saw a pullback from Monday's impressive over 3% gain. First Metro Investment's Christina Ulang, though, is staying positive on risk assets, saying the index is already pricing in the good prospects of further reopening.
This is at the higher trading range, where our PE is already at the level of 19. But forward, we're very cheap, still at 16 times PE, 22, 23, 14 times PE. And so the foreigners are, I think, together with the local fund managers, are thinking of repositioning already for 2022. The volatility is really very exciting. It gives you an opportunity to make money, because if we're going to observe last May, we were at 6,124. We rose 10% and reached 7,000. And then we dove again, deep again to like 6,003 in August 13. Mm-hmm. And then we're now at the above 7,000 level, and that gives you a 10% return. So had you been investing, like doing the range trading, you have earned like 10% twice in a row in the last 4 months.
As for State Pension Fund Social Security System, or SSS, it says its mandate is to stay cash ready for now, ready to deploy funds to Filipinos during the pandemic. The biggest chunk of its 642 billion peso fund is still with government securities at 44% and equities at 17%. SSS Executive Vice President Rizaldi Capulong says they remain constructive on risky assets and may start deploying funds overseas soon.
Overall, the portfolio has a 4.9%, 4.93% ROI as of end of August, and equities has a 5.67% ROI, and government securities 5.12% ROI.
For the day, the PSE index shed a quarter of 1% to close at 71.07. Among the day's most actively traded stocks, big winners from previous sessions gave up some of their gains amid profit-taking. Semidata, meanwhile, jumping 10% following news of record dividend payout. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Robert Greene. Deception is the most potent weapon in the game of power.
And that is The World Tonight, the 12th of October, 2021. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!